Material witness warrants have been issued in the Northern District of Illinois for Professor Lu Chen, Dr. Lily Sinclair, and Edward Kosolovich.
Keanu Reeves is on the run after a lab experiment levels 8 city blocks in the techno-thriller Chain Reaction. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Yes, Chain Reaction is supposedly a techno-thriller about discovering who sabotaged an experiment to create a new low-cost fuel out of water. But really, it's a study of Keanu Reeves on the run. He's constantly running in this picture, first away from that explosion at a laboratory in a converted Chicago steel mill. On Chicago's Michigan Avenue, which has a famous bridge. It's almost like he's playing the role the bus played in his earlier movie, Speed. When his legs get tired, well, there's a boat to carry him and a colleague, a boring scientist character played by Rachel Weisz. They have no chemistry together.
Daddy, what are you doing?
The best I can!
The only juice in this film comes from the wonderful voice and line readings by Morgan Freeman, whose tone conveys a great deal of seriousness, even when we don't believe it for a minute. Freeman plays Reeves' mentor and the head of the energy project.
Time to go, Eddie. We've got a job to complete. The experiment needs verifying. Do your work. This will all be over.
The director of Chain Reaction is Andrew Davis, who previously created such strong entertainments as The Fugitive and Under Siege. But Chain Reaction doesn't have the heroes or the villains or the inherent drama of The Fugitive, nor does it have the tension or humor of Under Siege. It does have some nifty explosions and lots of running, but that doesn't make a satisfying movie.
I wasn't satisfied either, Gene, and yet I thought the visuals were great. Andrew Davis has a terrific eye in setting up these chase sequences, right, and in modulating them. I like Morgan Freeman's performance, but the movie didn't make any sense.
Right.
I couldn't figure it out. It seemed like, in a way, if these people wanted to control this device to get free energy, then they shouldn't be doing anything that they were doing. And I couldn't follow any of the motives. And at another point, they're running around in an ice boat on a frozen lake in Wisconsin. The next scene, they're in Washington, D.C. I have no idea how they got there. At the end of the movie, I couldn't have explained it to you at all, even though I liked a lot of what I saw.
They get the hardware right and the story wrong. Mm-hmm. And I think if you get the story right, the hardware seems to take care of itself.
That's such a simple point.
I know.
You'd think somebody else would have thought of it in addition to...
We ought to have all the jobs in Hollywood.
Well, that would be nice, wouldn't it? But we'd be very busy. Okay, next movie. And our next movie tells the story of a very bright little girl with very stupid parents who send her to the cruelest school in the world, where she meets the best teacher she could possibly hope for. The name of the movie is Matilda, and it stars Danny DeVito and Rhea Perlman as the neglectful parents of a daughter they don't really want to send to school at all.
I want to go to school.
School. Out of the question. Who would be here to sign for the packages?
That's Mara Wilson as Matilda, who has been taking care of herself since she was 2 and has read most of the books in the library. Her parents finally send her to the awful Crunchham Hall, where the terrifying Agatha Trunchbull is the principal. Her motto, if you're having fun, you're not learning. Pam Ferris plays Trunchbull in a state of unceasing rage.
What's funny? Come on, spit it out. Speak up. I like a joke as well as the next fat person.
But Matilda is lucky to get the wonderful Miss Honey, played by Imbeth Davids, as her teacher, and she makes a quick impression with her mental skills.
Pretty soon you'll be able to do any multiplication, whether it's 2 times 7.
14.
Very good, or 13 times 379.
4,927.
I beg your pardon?
I think that's the answer. 13 times 379. 4,927.
That's not all Matilda can do with her remarkable mind. The movie is based on a book by Roald Dahl, who specializes in the macabre, and only the sunny figure of Miss Honey keeps Matilda from being trapped in a completely unfriendly world. Matilda is very funny at times and also very serious about its fantasy, which kids will enjoy because they'll know they're not being talked down to.
I liked lots of this movie, but not all of it, Roger. And here, let me tell you two problems I had with it. One, I love the setup. I think the premise is spectacular with her, and you didn't even mention this, being seriously interested in books.
Yeah.
She loves books, and of course he can't understand.
I said she'd read every book in the library.
She can't understand why, her father can't understand why she wouldn't want to read TV when she has to do the work of reading books, and that's great. But then when they get to the school, and it turns into a juvenile carry, if you will, with her using the superpowers, and there are lots of scenes, so many scenes, I thought they blew the most obvious opportunity. I know they're adapting a book, but it's sitting right in front of them, and that is this. Have her powers not come from special effects department, but have them come from the learning she's done in the books. It would reinforce things so beautifully, it would have made a great movie, not as it's presently constructed.
Well, but you recommend it, don't you?
Roger, I'm not going to recommend it.
Why not?
Because I felt that...
Well, you didn't recommend it because you could have made a better movie.
No. The reason is because there's a flaw. And so, therefore, when I see
flaw... That's a choice that you wouldn't have made.
No, because it wasn't working. Obviously, I never second-guess something that I think is working.
What about the characters of Trunchbull and Miss Honey? Aren't they wonderful?
You know what? All the stuff with Honey. Trunchbull's a cardboard figure, and I get a little tired of her. Miss Honey, I thought that would have been better played out. I thought the dialogue would have been sharper between those actresses. I'll give one more compliment. Mara Wilson is an actress who can play other roles. She's going to grow up to be a big-time actress.
Okay, coming up next, she may be best known as Brad Pitt's girlfriend, but in Emma, Gwyneth Paltrow has a starring role all of her own.
Yeah, but I thought you said you felt nothing for him.
Yes, but he did not know that. He is benefiting from a very lucky coincidence. She was as selfless a friend as I have ever had. And I hope to say someday I have done half as much for someone as Mrs. Weston did for me.
You must be happy that she settled so well.
Indeed. One matter of joy, and this is that I made the match myself.
That's Gwyneth Paltrow as Jane Austen's terribly decent and upbeat heroine, Emma, who nonetheless spends so much time making matches and meddling in the lives of her friends and relatives that, of course, she has no romantic life of her own. Among so many recent fine Jane Austen films, including Persuasion, Sense and Sensibility, and even the contemporary adaptation Clueless, Emma stands out as a jewel of light comedy, satire, and tenderness set in early 19th century England. In a star-making role, Gwyneth Paltrow plays Emma, who wants to marry off friends and acquaintances like the simple and awkward Harriet Smith, played by the fine actress Toni Collette from Muriel's Wedding. Here she promotes a match with the local vicar, played by Alan Cumming.
Oh, dear! Oh! My lace! Oh, please have the goodness to go on, and I will rejoin you as soon as I can.
Emma is all sunshine and light when arranging for others to fall in love, but when affection is directed at her by the very same vicar, she's shocked.
But you to address me in this manner after your behavior to Miss Smith...
I never cared whether Miss Smith were dead or alive, except that she was your friend. Who can think of Miss Smith when Miss Woodhouse is near?
The one confidant in Emma's life is her handsome bachelor brother-in-law, played by Jeremy Northam. He's often bemused by Emma playing Cupid, but he gets unusually upset when Emma attempts to turn off Harriet Smith from the advances of a kindly farmer.
She is a gentleman's daughter.
Whoever her parents, they made no plans to introduce her into good society. She was left with Mrs. Goddard for an indifferent education. Her friends evidently thought this was good enough for her, and it was. And she thought so too until you began to puff her up. Vanity working on a weak mind produces every kind of mischief.
You dismiss her beauty and good nature, yet I would be very much mistaken if your sex in general does not think those claims the highest a woman could possess.
I found Emma to be an absolutely charming entertainment, perfectly paced so that its inevitable payoff was charged with genuine and honestly earned emotion. Emma is a rare thing these days at the movies, a light romantic comedy that works. But it also has the richness of Jane Austen's characterizations and a cast, a really fine cast that's more than equal to them. As for Gwyneth Paltrow, this is the role that properly establishes her own name as a major acting talent.
Oh yeah, she's wonderful in this movie. You can see that she's very bright and very funny and very perceptive, and she finds just the right note for this material, and all the material works. And you know what I think explains the fact that Jane Austen is really the most popular author in Hollywood right now? It's the other side of the coin we saw in Chain Reaction. People are tired of special effects. Some people are.
Yeah.
And they love a movie that plays by the rules, where there are all these social rules and good manners and ways of behaving and ways of not behaving.
When you compare this kind of movie to movies without explosions, without all the special effects, the writing of the English character movies is deeper.
Yes.
By that I mean they go 7 characters deep, 8 characters deep. And in American movies, they go 3 or 4 characters deep. And we're thrilled by that. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to have fluff to support the 3 characters. You meet more people.
And you know, they even let people talk for 3 or 4 sentences at a time.
We do that once in a while. When we come back, a drama named Stonewall about the birth of the gay pride movement.
Hey, watch in Philadelphia.
For what?
Homosexual rights.
A young man from a small town arrives in New York's Greenwich Village in 1969 in that scene, hoping that here his homosexuality will be more accepted than it was back home. But he finds things are really not much better in the village. And his first night in town, he's in a gay bar named the Stonewall Inn when it's raided by the police.
Hands up, faggot.
Leave him alone! Come on, he ain't hurting nobody, right?
That's Frederick Weller as Matty Dean. He soon begins a relationship with a drag queen named La Miranda, played by Guillermo Diaz, as someone who was sworn never again to get involved or take emotional chances.
I'm scared, Matty. I ain't never had no hero before. I never kissed no one before. Or made love.
But you ain't never been loved like this before, baby.
Matty also becomes friendly with Ethan, played by Brendan Corballis, who, like many gay men at the time, put a lot of emphasis on projecting a respectable mainstream image. He doesn't much approve of drag queens. Stonewall recreates a time when almost all homosexual love was secret, underground, and illegal, and it shows the Stonewall riot when gays for the first time fought back against police brutality. Stonewall is a fictionalized version of a factual book about its time and place. And like a lot of docudramas, it feels like the background facts are taking precedence over the drama and the characters. I often felt as if characters were talking just to deliver information, and I would have preferred either a pure fiction film or a documentary. There's good stuff here, but it's unfocused.
See, I like this picture, Roger, and I want to give you an example of something that I liked, and I don't care if this is word for word, but I know that it has the finger of truth to it, the feel of truth to it, and that is... In talking about the Mattachine Society, where we meet the old guard that was promoting
dress
gay
up
rights.
In suits, look real conservative.
Okay, but the film is very respectful to them. A cheaper film, and I don't think there's anything cheap about this picture.
No.
I think it's really quite strong. Would have used those people as a punching bag, but it's this film is about taking stands, and that's the stand that was taken then. And then here we come in the watershed years of the late '60s, and a new, more activist. A guard takes over. And I thought that the film really was a fine historical document emotionally. I think
it has a lot of good information in it and a lot of good performances,
especially
that subplot involving the bar owner. But I just felt that in a way it was trying to do two jobs when it should have done one job or the other.
Roger, I think this drama does work. I think the emotional truth of each and every character and situation even has applicability to today. When we come back, we'll identify the major trend of this summer's movie hits. What's at the center of $1 billion worth of tickets? Okay, I just promised the secret of the summer's biggest hits, and here's the clue. It's a 4-letter word starting with B. Want to buy a vowel, Roger? How about O? There are two of them. Boom. That's right, boom. Explosions are omnipresent this summer in hit after hit. Let's count the explosions, beginning with Twister. And then there's The Rock.
Fire.
And of course, the summer's biggest hit, Independence Day. And boom, there goes the aquarium in Eraser. And a bomb goes off at the beginning of Mission Impossible, but boom, here comes another exploding aquarium. Now that films that go boom should be hits during the summer should surprise no one. Think about it. The centerpiece of the summer is what? The 4th of July. The centerpiece of the 4th of July is what? The fireworks show. Roadside fireworks stands are open all summer, not in the fall. And if we can't get fireworks on the 4th of July, the 5th of July, or the 5th of August, I guess we have some natural urge to see them in movie theaters. And the studios know it, so explosions are the centerpiece of the 30-second TV ads for these movies. Here's the ad for Chain Reaction.
Now, the only survivors.
Someone set this up.
Have become the only suspects.
We don't trust anyone.
From the director of The Fugitive. Keanu Reeves, Morgan Freeman, Chain Reaction.
And what's amazing to me, with all the real-life terror with bombs this year, there seems to be no lack of interest in seeing explosions on the screen, although I'm getting tired of it.
Well, Gene, you know, there are a couple of elements here that I think you've suggested. One is, if you're going to put together a 30-second or a 15-second or 10-second TV ad, it just takes a second to show the White House being blown up. It takes a lot longer to have dialogue.
Exactly.
Number two, it seems to me that there is a basic desire on the part of people. It's a juvenile desire.
Exactly.
To see stuff like this. Remember when David Letterman used to drop watermelons off of towers, and in slow motion you saw it explode?
Sure. Loved it.
I loved it, too. It was very entertaining. Right. And third, remember the old SCTV show where they reviewed
it up real big.
This stuff blowed up real good. There is a certain bottom line in which, and it's very simple, in which you like to see stuff blowing up.
We like to sit in front of fire.
It's adolescent, but it's universal.
And it is universal in movies today. When we come back, a tribute to the late, great Claudette Colbert.
Siskel and Ebert's Video Pick of the Week, brought to you by Orville Redenbacher's Gourmet Popping Corn, the best part of the movies.
Hollywood lost one of its great leading ladies this week when Claudette Colbert died at the age of 91. She began in the silent days, but was a gifted comedian with a knack for dialogue and grew up with the talkies, especially in screwball comedies. Her first enormous hit was Frank Capra's immortal comedy It Happened One Night in 1935, where she played a poor little rich girl and Clark Gable played a wisecracking newspaper man, and they fell in love on a bus. Here's the famous Walls of Jericho scene.
Good night's rest will do you a lot of good. Besides, you got nothing to worry about. The Walls of Jericho will protect you from the big bad wolf.
Colbert also sparkled in Preston George's 1942 comedy, The Palm Beach Story, this time as a runaway wife who falls into the lives of the wealthy Mary Astor and her very strange, very funny brother, played by Rudy Valley.
Put it away.
What?
Put it away.
But, darling.
I'll just take one more look at it and then put it away forever. There's a limit to what a woman can stand.
And maybe not one of her great films, but one of my personal favorites, The Egg and I from 1947, had Colbert playing best-selling author Betty McDonald, who left the city to run a chicken farm.
There. I'll bet you've never looked as good as this in your whole life.
She continued to work through the 50s and 60s and even made a couple of movies in the 80s. Claudette Colbert, dead at 91. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs down for the visually exciting Chain Reaction, which looked good but didn't make much sense. A split decision, though, for Danny DeVito's dark family comedy Matilda about a smart little girl and her dumb parents. I liked its irreverence. Gene thought it should have done more with her natural skills. Two thumbs up for Gwyneth Paltrow and Douglas McGrath's Emma, another Jane Austen comedy about matchmaking, marriage, and misunderstandings. She's terrific. Finally, a split decision for Stonewall, which contains some interesting material but suffers from not really being a fiction film or a documentary, according to me, according to Gene. He really liked the strong historical, emotional material.
That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Jack, starring Robin Williams as a 10-year-old boy in a 40-something body, directed by Francis Coppola. And also, Escape from L.A., starring Kurt Russell as an outlaw in what's left of Los Angeles after the big one finally hit.
Your rules are really beginning to annoy me.
That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.